phones put them in worship mode. Thank you.
We're going to start the service.
Good morning and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of the South Jersey Shore. Our service is open to all, friends, visitors, and members. Whether you are single, partnered, or a family of any type, we welcome you. Whether you are here in the sanctuary with us, or watching live online, or on demand, may our time together be one of learning and celebration. To those joining us virtually, we welcome your comments as well as your joys and sorrows on that platform. Please remember, however, that this video will be on the internet, so do not share something that's best kept private. My name is Paul Upps. I am your worship associate this morning. I am a charter member and also a member of the Board of Trustees, and they let me sing in the choir. Our worship service today is led by Reverend Dr. Richard Speck, who is a retired district executive for the Joseph Priestley District, or as we know it, JPD, of the Unitarian Universalist Association of Congregations. He was named Minister Emeritus in 2019. Previously, he served 9 years as minister to the Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Vero Beach, Florida, before coming to JPD in 2000 as acting district executive. In his last 2 years in Florida, he also served as the music director for the church. He graduated from Meadville Lombard Theological School with a doctorate in ministry in 1990. He was hired as a regular district executive in 2001. He served 14 years as district executive before retiring from full-time ministry in 2014. Richard continues to be active in social justice programs like Black Lives Matter and the coalition that dismantled the new Jim Crow in Delaware. He conducts weddings, memorial services, and funerals, and continues preaching in area congregations. He also serves as treasurer of the UU Ministers Association twice, finishing his second three-year term in 2020. He is currently treasurer of the UU Retired Ministers and Partners Association. He also served as treasurer for the Priestley Kingsbury UUMA for the last 6 years. Richard became Unitarian Universalist as a layperson in Springfield, Massachusetts in 1974. He was an active lay member of the Unitarian Universalist Church of Birmingham, Alabama, before going into ministry. In that congregation, he held a variety of leadership positions: vice president, secretary, canvasser, choir member, and lay delegate, and was active in the social life of the church. Richard's career before ministry was as a respiratory therapist for 18 years. The last 10 years before seminary were spent in Birmingham as the director of respiratory care department in a large hospital where he supervised over 30 people in multiple divisions of that department. He earned an MA in healthcare administration in 1976 as part of his career. He left healthcare to pursue new avenues of servicing humanity through the ministry. He is married to Janet Tillman and resides in Wilmington, Delaware. He enjoys making music, flying his own plane, that he flew here this morning, and creating stained glass art. Janet and Richard have 2 cats. Video of the service will be available on YouTube channel later today. If you care to tweet during today's service, you can use the hashtag UCSJS. But I also want to add about Richard. He was here on this very spot a little less than 20 years ago when we had our groundbreaking to build our beautiful sanctuary. He was here when we became, you know, when we opened the building. He was here for an ordination that occurred here. So he's really been a really important, and I'll have more to say about that later, a really important member of our congregational development, and helped us through both turbulent times, reminding us to breathe, but as equally important through celebration. Chalice lady this morning is my sister and fellow charter member, Marcia Hannah. Please join me in reading the chalice lighting words contained in your order of service. I light the flame of this chalice for us to gather this day to reaffirm our being in community with one another. We light this chalice also for that greater community of which we are a part, the whole human family. May this light serve as a beacon of hope and love to all, especially to those who struggle with grieving, with illness, with loneliness of this day. For all who suffer, may this light bring warmth and healing.
Please rise now in body or spirit for our gathering here with number 349. We gather together.
We're going to do this a little different today. Paul has been asked to sing a cappella himself, the first verse, and then Cynthia is going to come in, and we are all going to sing both verses together. We gather together, verse 1 and 2. So Paul's going to hit it.
Gather together in joyful thanksgiving, acclaiming creation whose bounty we share. Both sorrow and gladness we find now in our living. We sing a hymn of praise to the life that we bear.
We gather together in joyful thanksgiving, acclaiming creation whose bounty we share. All sorrow and gladness we find now we are living. We sing a hymn of praise to God.
We light this lantern for our children and youth, and for us, celebrating the flame of faith lighted in each of us, honoring the light each of us brings into the world, rejoicing in community that we make together. The children will now collect donations from local food pantries, animal shelter, and the Coalition Against Grain Abuse. Provided in the foyer, in which you are invited to write whatever joys and sorrows you have.
Oh, jump on the gun. Yeah. It's exciting.
Go with wisdom, go with wonder, go to meet a brand new day. Learn to see the within you as we sit.
loving community, and my joy of working with our choir. We had a wonderful rehearsal on Saturday, full of love and good cheer. I am counting my blessings. Thank you all. Love, Gina. My joy is having a healthy, beautiful granddaughter, born 9/11/22. Not sure where that's from, but that's from Miriam. And her granddaughter's visiting this week, which she's very excited. Concern, the ever-rising rate of violence in America. 5 dead, many wounded at a gay nightclub in Colorado last night.
Yes.
Please say no motive known yet. Mm-hmm. Just hate. Mm-hmm. So sad. And this from John C. Wright. It is my joy to have Reverend Speck with us today. Reverend Speck played many important roles that helped us as a new congregation and in raising funds to help us finance the construction of this beautiful Union Center. We received 2 key chalice letter grants totaling $60,208, partially thanks to Richard. When we were summarily evicted from the Catholic Campus Center because of our support for the GLBT community and because we had invited a gay rights advocate to speak at Stockton University, Dr. Speck flew in on Sunday to stand with us as we asserted our right to continue to meet in the Campus Center. Reverend Speck was also a firm supporter of our Black Lives Matter sign when we experienced many instances of defacing the sign. In gratitude for Reverend Speck's support, courage, and wisdom. And that again from John C. Wright. And I also thank you. Pastoral prayer? Okay. Before the offertory.
Are we going to do the pebble?
Just going to give a little pastoral prayer. I'll be back for the offertory.
Okay.
Oh, right, the Joyce Miller.
Have you done this before?
That was the acapella. But, yes. Sorry.
We just like people to get up and get down. To get up and get down.
And,
you gotta get up to get down.
Right, during the musical interlude, we invite you to save some quiet time together. You may wish to drop a pebble in the communal water on either side of the chancel, symbolizing our shared experience of joys and concerns in our lives.
So let us enter into a moment of reflection as you are bringing the pebbles forward. We are grateful to be here in community, to hear the joys and sorrows that come into our lives. We're grateful for the opportunity to make music together, to welcome a granddaughter into the world, hopefully surrounded by love. But we are also saddened to hear of the violence that is done to those who are LGBTQ+. Knowing that our world is still full of hatred for the other. And we're grateful that there are those who have supported the congregation through the many years that have come to the fruition of today. For this and much more, we are grateful and we continue to offer our thanks. Thank you.
We're going to now sing the response, Joy in Abundance. The words are in here.
Prayer can be spoken or silent, It need not be addressed to any deity we know or can name. What it should do is express our sense of joyful participation with the gracious forces of life. If you don't like mine, say a prayer of your own, or use the old cowboys. The important thing is to give thanks for all the bumps and bruises along the way. It does remain a heck of a ride.
So when I was serving a congregation those many years ago, I asked a question as a thought stimulator for this sermon in a new November newsletter. I said, how do we show gratitude and what brings us hope in the world? Another way of asking the question is, what are we thankful for and in what way should we express our thankfulness? An old man was down on his luck and was panhandling on Fifth Avenue before the annual Thanksgiving Day parade got underway in New York City. As an obviously well-to-do couple strolled by, he called out, "May the blessing of the Lord, which brings love and joy and wealth and a fine family, follow you all the days of your life." There was a pause as the couple passed his outstretched hand without contributing. Then he shouted after them, "And never catch up to you." This man would have been thankful for any assistance which would come his way from that couple. When it didn't materialize and his hopes were dashed, he responded, as many of us would, with callous words meant to vent our frustrations. One of the harder lessons in life that we learn is that we don't always receive what we feel we deserve. "I should have gotten that raise, not the other person. They aren't as good, as smart, as industrious, as fill in the blank, as I am." Yet we are given many things for which we can give thanks. We have to notice them before we do. We in this country don't stop to realize what type of life we really have. As the last few days of the year wind down and everyone anticipates a new era of opportunity, how many of us have given thanks that we live in a country not at war? How many of us appreciate that we have enough to eat or enough clothes to wear or a place to shelter us from the elements? As I read the newspaper and watch the television and the internet, I am reminded that there are famines. There are epidemics, there are wars, there are tragedies of immense proportion happening in other parts of this small globe. And here I am, comfortable, secure, well-fed, contented with my lot in life. Reflecting upon these things brings our lives into sharper focus as to what we truly have for which we can give thanks this season. Now, Snoopy is getting dog food for his Thanksgiving Day dinner, and he is aware that everyone else in the family is inside having turkey. He meditates and talks to himself. How about that? Everyone is eating turkey today, but just because I'm a dog, I get dog food. He trots away and positions himself on top of his doghouse and concludes, "Of course, it could have been worse. I could have been born a turkey." So as we look back to the founding celebration of Thanksgiving Day, we discover that things had been pretty grim for the pilgrims. The pilgrims sailing across the Atlantic Ocean on the Mayflower landed at Plymouth Rock in December of 1620. The pilgrims lived off of their provisions through the hard New England winter. They planted a communal garden in the summer, but the settlers didn't know how to plant Indian corn, and the crop was small. In November 1621, more pilgrims arrived without adequate provisions. Governor William Bradford was worried when he calculated that the food would only last 6 months at half ration per person. After the second hard winter, another ship arrived in May 1622 with seven more pilgrims and some letters, but no food. The food supply was almost gone, and these early settlers were starving. In the summer of 1622, another ship arrived, which brought some food. The ration was now a quarter of a pound of bread per day. Because of their hunger, settlers were going to their community garden and stealing the food. The thieves were whipped when caught. The communal garden idea wasn't working. So in early 1623, the settlers decided to parcel out the land to individual families and let all families tend their crops. Governor Bradford wrote that everyone worked harder under this plan. In his words, "The women now went willingly into ye field and took their little ones with them to set corn, which before would allege weakness and disability, whom to have compelled would have been through great tyranny and oppression." The settlers, after planting their seeds in the spring of 1623, were deeply concerned whether the crops would grow. Governor Bradford noted that all of the families really meant it when they prayed, "Lord, give us this day our daily bread." When the next ship arrived in the summer of 1623, the passengers were shocked and frightened by the look of the starving pilgrims. In autumn 1623, the harvest of the pilgrims' private gardens was now a great success. In this spirit of deep gratitude to God, Governor Bradford declared a day of thanksgiving. Harvests were plentiful in the years to come. But the pilgrims put five kernels of corn by their dinner plates on Thanksgiving to remind them of the great suffering endured by the first settlers. They never gave up hope of succeeding. What will we put by our dinner plates this holiday to remind us for what we are thankful? Can we take a step back from everyday activities and compose a list of those areas of our lives in which we feel truly blessed by the divine or fate? Or will we be stuck in a mode of not ever being satisfied with what we have? A middle-aged man, famous for constantly complaining, a nuisance to everyone who knew him, inherited a lot of money. After observing that it wasn't as much as he thought it should be, he told his wife, a gentle, sweet-spirited woman, that he thought he would buy some acreage for them to enjoy in their retirement. "What do you think I should name my spread?" he asked. And she replied, "Why don't you call it Belly Acres?" A reading by Richard Kelleway speaks of having hope within ourselves. He says, but I found myself drawn into my surroundings. At first, I thought the scene was pretty. Soon, I was pulled beyond beauty. The brightness sparkling across the slowly surging water touched and included me. The sunfire heat penetrated with encompassing warmth. The islands floated. Boats flowed into elemental forms, and gulls danced serenely before me. And I was dissolved into the elemental stuff of life. The author describes this trip to the harbor where he becomes aware of the oneness of the universe. In this experience, he found hope which provided him with serenity to ride out the troubled waters through which each life must pass. Hope is that feeling that the future will be brighter and better. Without hope, the pilgrims would have given up their quest for a new community, even in the face of the harsh winters. So it is an optimism that more happiness will come into our lives. Sometimes, our optimism knows no bounds and is unrealistic. An American touring in the Sahara was dressed in a bathing suit. A Bedouin gazed at him in amazement. "I'm going swimming," the tourist said. "But the ocean is 800 miles away," the Arab informed him. 800 miles, the American exclaimed with a huge smile. "Boy, what a beach." This person was a bit too confident in their hopes. Psychologist William Marston asked 3,000 people, "What have you to live for?" He was shocked to discover that 94% were simply enduring the present while they waited for the future. Waited for something to happen, waited for next year, waited for a better time, waited for someone to die, waited for tomorrow, unable to see that all anyone ever has is today. Because yesterday is gone and tomorrow exists only in hope. We can appreciate what we have today and be grateful even as we look to a better future. The sorcerer had fallen out of favor of the court, and the king sentenced him to death. On the day of the planned execution, the sorcerer told the king that if he would allow him to live for 1 year, the king could become famous around the world, because the sorcerer would make the king's horse talk. If the sorcerer failed, the king could kill him, and the sorcerer wouldn't object. The king agreed, and the sorcerer was spared for 1 year and dispatched to a dungeon. A duke, who was friendly to the sorcerer, sneaked up to the dungeon and he said, "You are indeed a fool. I know, and you know, that you do not have the power to make animals speak. Now you will surely die." Answered the sorcerer, "I have a year. Many things can happen in a year. The king might die, or I might die. And who knows? Perhaps in a year, the horse might talk." Now that's an optimism ungrounded in reality. If you were asked the question, "What have you to live for?" how would you answer? Would you speak about some future goal which you must achieve, or would you tell about the events that are in your life that bring you joy now? Would it be things to amass or people to love? Would it be acquisitions of objects, or would it be accessibility to others? The things that bring me hope are the little actions that I and others do to make the world better. When I see an adult spending time with a child, when I see a friend comforting another in pain, when I hear kind words spoken to total strangers, I have more hope that we are learning the ways of peace and harmony. When I observe people making a difference in another's life, I am warmed with a glow that the world can be made whole. An anonymous reading helps me to know what brings me hope and what brings me gratitude. It is grounded in how we live our lives in relationship with others. It may sound familiar to you. If I can throw a single ray of light across the darkened pathway of another, if I can aid some soul in clearer sight of life and duty, and thus bless my brother, if I can wipe from any human cheek a tear, I shall not have lived my life in vain while here. If I can guide some erring one to truth, inspire within her heart a sense of duty, if I can plant within my soul of rosy youth a sense of right, a love of truth and beauty, if I can teach one person that God in heaven are near, I shall not then have lived in vain while here. If from my mind I banish doubt and fear and keep my life attuned to love and kindness, if I can scatter light and hope and cheer and help remove the curse of mental blindness, if I can make more joy, more hope, less pain, I shall not have lived and loved in vain. If by life's roadside I can plant a tree beneath whose shade some weary head may rest, though I may never share its beauty, I shall yet be truly blessed. Though no one knows my name, nor drops a flower upon my grave, I shall not have lived in vain while here. As we approach the holiday where we acknowledge our gratefulness, may we be thankful for those hands that have touched ours, the love that has flowed from one to the other, the opportunities that daily come for us to show kindness to strangers. For when each of these qualities of living are lifted up, we gain a renewed hope that tomorrow will dawn bright and clear. May your thanksgiving be abundant and your hope overflowing. Amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn, I think, is next. And it is 331, if I remember.
We will be singing verse 1 and 3 of closing hymn number 331, Life is the Greatest Gift of All. And Cynthia is going to grace us with Gaertner's song, one time for everyone to get it in their ears. Cynthia, thanks.
Life is the
go now to take up the path once again. In the days which pass, may we be bearers of love to all we meet. May we see to do justice and love mercy in our interactions. Let us be bold in our living, our loving, our hoping, until the world be transformed and all shall have peace. Amen.
Amen.
Let us read the words together for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this flame,
but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry on our hearts until we are together again.
I have to tune this puppy itself. It's not liking the different temperatures. The song that I'm going to play for you right now is a song I wrote that came through me as I watched my awesome husband, John. Colby, you know all about how awesome he is. And I saw him interacting with our daughters, and I just thought how lucky my daughters are, and I thought about how lucky I am. Teresa, we're so lucky.
We're so lucky.
We're so lucky. And so the song came through, and it's called Thankfully. And I'm supposed to whistle in the front, but my whistle's not been working well, so if anybody has a good whistle, go for it. Thank you.
few announcements today. There will be a Faith Action Committee meeting today at 11:15 downstairs in the green room. There will also be a Leadership Council meeting downstairs in the yellow room. Postcards available today to be signed and sent to New Jersey legislators urging support for the Reproductive Equality Act, Senate Bill number 2918. This bill will protect and expand abortion access for all people here in New Jersey, regardless of income, insurance, or immigration status. The bill also strengthens protection for healthcare providers. More information will be provided at the sign-up table. Please stop by. If you haven't already, please send your favorite family recipe to Gina today for use for next week's service.
Please do it soon now. I'm trying to get them all together for next week's service. Thank you.
The men's group will be meeting this Tuesday night. For all you men or people who identify as such, love to see you for pizza, maybe an adult beverage or two. It's a nice time. The caring team is looking for members who are willing to attend the monthly Zoom meeting and help out when congregants are sick or suffering from hardships. Please contact Tracy Catino if you can join our confidential group. The UUC-SJS Board of Trustees would like to hear from you about a potential change in the start time of Sunday service. If you open up the survey, you'll see there's a choice to either keep it the same, to maybe meet a half an hour earlier at 10:30, or even an hour earlier at 11 o'clock. And this only goes to the end of April. You know, during the dark and cold months, and then we'll go from there and decide if we want to continue to meet at 10 or if we want to move the service time a little later. So please open up that email and reply. Join us next Sunday for our own Gina Roche, who is excited to invite the congregation to our November 27th Share a Beloved Recipe, Share Your Heart service. A service where we will be recipe sharing and cooking up some joy, good music, and thankfulness at the UU. Gina's family origin is of Spanish, Cuban, and Irish heritage. Quite the mutt. Growing up in a family of seven, there were many traditional Cuban dishes gracing the table. Her abuela, aka Nana, made the absolute best food. It was always a celebration when Nana came to town with her arroz con pollo.
Arroz con pollo.
Picadillo de moro.
Picadillo.
Every St. Patty's Day, there was homemade Irish soda bread, ham, and cabbage, and they made sweet Irish potatoes from her Philadelphia side. We warmly welcome all of you who are visiting us today. Parents are encouraged to stay for the final moments of worship and to receive their children from outside or downstairs after the bell has sounded. Now let us share in a moment of silent reflection to consider today's message and its meaning in our lives.
I was at